Okay, so in this video, we are going to learn about frequency tables. And histograms. Frequency tables are a good way to organize your data so that you're not just looking at a big chunk of data. You know, if you're thinking about your audience that you're going to be presenting the results of your data analysis to, you don't just want to hand them a big old, stack of data and say, here's what we found. You want to take that data and you want to organize it in a way that's going to make sense to them. And one of the ways that we can do that is to put the data into a frequency table, which talks about the frequency, in other words, how many items fall into a particular grouping. And then a histogram is a graphical display of the information that's in a frequency table. So these two things are definitely related. Frequency tables in general tend to have the same headings when you're looking at making a frequency table. There tends to be a heading called class limits. Then there's a heading called class boundaries. Then some books will put in a column for the tally. Whoops, I'm not going to do that. We won't have a tally column. Our next column will be frequency, and then relative frequency. And again, some books will have a final column over here that says cumulative frequency. We're going to ignore that. We're just going to have class limits, class boundaries, frequency, and relative frequency. Oh, and midpoint. Okay. Let's try this one more time. So we'll have class limits, class boundaries, midpoint, frequency, and relative frequency. Okay, so those are our headings. And then what we do with these, let's say that we have a set of data. First, I'm going to outline my table here really quickly just so I know I have enough space for it. There we go. Okay. And let's say that my set of data is 1, 5, 5, 6, 7, 4, 8, 7, 6, 5, 5, 6, 7, 6, 6, 5, 8, 9, 9, and 10, 7, 8, 11, 2, 4, 6, 5, 12, 13, and 6, and then 3, 7, 8, 8, 9, 9, 10, 9, 8, 9. Okay, so there's all of my data. Now again, this is not a handy way to look at the data. If I just tried to give this to a group of people and say, yay, here was the data, you can't really observe any decent trends from this, and it's not a particularly nice way to look at the data. It's not organized in any meaningful way. So what we could do is we could organize this data according to a frequency table, which means we would report the class limits, class boundaries, midpoint frequency, and relative frequency. Let's say that we want to divide this data into, let's say, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 classes. So we want to create a frequency table. I want to use 5 classes. Now, in actual practice, whoever it is that's organizing the data would get to select how many classes to use. For the purposes of the textbook, so that we all get the same frequency table and therefore the same histogram, you'll be told how many classes to use, and it just means how many groupings you're dividing this up into. Then what you do that with that information is you look at your data, and you look at the smallest piece of data in the entire data set, which is a little tricky with this set of data because it's out of order, but here's our smallest piece of data. It's this number 1, and that's where your first class starts. Then we need to figure out how far that first class goes. It starts with the data point of one, but if we want five classes, how many pieces of data do we include in there? So what we do to determine what's called the class width is we take the maximum value of the data minus the minimum value of the data and divide by the desired number of classes. So in our case, we already decided our minimum data value was 1. Our maximum data value, just scanning through here, appears to be 13. So we'd be looking at 13 minus 1 over 5, which is 2.4. And when we're finding class width, this is a little unusual because we don't normally do this in math, but regardless of what this number comes out to, we're always going to round it up to the next highest integer. So our class width here came out to exactly 2.4, which means we're going to round it up to 3. Okay. So that means these class limits have to be 3 units apart. Each class is going to contain 3 units of data. So this class limit, the first lower class limit is 1. Then when we add 3 to get to the next class, it's going to start at 4. Add 3 to get to the next class, it'll start at 7. Add 3 to get to the next class, it'll start at 10. Add 3 to get to the next class, it'll start at 13. Okay, so there's our 5 classes. Then, this one starts at 4, so that means this one needs to go from 1 to 3. Then this one picks up at 4, 4 to 6. This one picks up at 7. This one starts at 10, so this has to go 7 to 9, then 10 to 12, since that one picks up at 13, and then 12 plus 3 would be 15. So you'll notice that there's a plus 3 pattern here, right? And same thing over here, plus 3, plus 3, plus 3. Plus 3. The reason that the magic number here is 3 is because that was our class width. If our class width had been 15, for example, this would be plus 15 every time. Okay, but in this case, ours was 3. So the first class will include data points from 1 to 3. We're going to group all of those together. Second class will include data points from 4 to 6, then from 7 to 9, 10 to 12, and 13 to 15. This next column, the reason that we're going to create it is not going to be obvious at all until we make the histogram. But basically, right now what we need to do is close this one unit gap between the classes. This one goes from 1 to 3, but this one doesn't pick up until 4. There's a one unit gap there. And there's also a one unit gap between 6 and 7 and 9 and 10 and 12 and 13. So the way that we close that gap is by converting class limits to class boundaries. For the lower class limit, we subtract a half a unit, and we add a half a unit to the upper class limit. So for our first lower class limit here of 1, we would subtract a half a unit, so that would be 0.5, and then we add a half a unit to the upper class limit, 3.5. So our class boundaries for the first class are 0.5 to 3.5. When we're looking at this next class down, 4 to 6, it's going to start at 3.5, and it's going to go to 6.5. So we, again, subtract a half from the lower, add a half to the upper, and you'll notice we've closed that one unit gap. They now touch at 3.5. This one, if we subtract a half, 6.5, add a half to the upper, 9.5, again, we've closed that one unit gap, 9.5 to 12.5, and 12.5 to 15.5. And again, you'll notice there's that 3 unit, you know, plus 3, plus 3, plus 3, etc. Okay, so class limits, and then to convert to class boundaries, subtract a half from the lower, add a half to the upper. Midpoint is exactly what it sounds like it is. It is the halfway point between your class limits or your class boundaries. And basically, to find your midpoint for the first class, you add together the two class limits and divide by 2. So here if I take 1 plus 3 would be 4, divide by 2 is 2. And we can also see that 2 is halfway between 1 and 3. To get the remaining midpoints for each class, you could, you know, 4 plus 6 is 10, divide by 2 is 5. It would have a midpoint of 5. 7 and 9 is 16, divide by 2 is 8, and so on and so forth. But you'll also notice that that plus 3 pattern is going to recur here as well. So our next midpoint will be 8, next one will be 11, and then 14. And again, that's all because our class width were 3. If our class width were 10, for example, there would be a plus 10 pattern here. Okay, so limits, boundaries, midpoint of each class. And then frequency is really the most labor-intensive column. That is where we actually figure out how many data points fall into each of these classes. So we need to count up how many data points are between 1 and 3. So here's 1. Okay, that's between 1 and 3. And then, let's see, any others that are between 1 and 3? There's a 2. There's a 3. And that appears to be it. So there are 3 data points in that first class. There are 3 pieces of data that have values between 1 and 3. Then 4 to 6, that's our next one. So again, we're just going to be counting those up. There's 1. 4 to 6, 4, 5, forgot the 5s. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. Okay, there are 15 pieces of data in that class. Then 7 to 9, so we'll be counting up the 7s, 8s, and 9s. So here's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, and 17. Then we're looking at 10 to 12, so 1, 2, 3, 4, and then our very last one here is 13, right, because 13 to 15, there's only one of those, 1. Okay, so there's our frequencies. We now know that there were 3 pieces of data with values 1 to 3, 15 pieces of data with values 4 to 6, 17, the most popular class is the number 7 through 9, there were 4 pieces of data in 10 through 12 and 1 piece of data in 13 through 15. So this is actually giving us a nice picture of how our data are distributed into these different classes. That's why it's so much easier to look at data organized in a frequency table rather than just in a big chunk. And then the very last column, relative frequency, that's where we take each of these pieces of, each of the frequencies and divide by the total number of data points to figure out what percentage of the data fall into each class. So for example, in this first class, there were 3 pieces of data out of 40 total pieces of data that were down here. So that represents 7.5%. Then for 15, if we take 15 and divide by 40, we're looking at 37.5%. And then you would simply do the same thing for the rest of these, 17 over 40, 4 over 40, and 1 over 40. You can leave them as fractions if you wanted to do that, but you would need to put them into lowest terms. So like this 4 over 40 would need to be 1 in 10. Or you can have them as decimals or percentages. They're all used interchangeably for the relative frequency column. And that's how you construct a frequency table. Class limits, boundaries, midpoint, frequency, and relative frequency. And in the next video, we'll take a look at converting this frequency table into a histogram.